Greater Reading ACT UP on BCTV is supported by the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theatres.
Hello, and welcome to Greater Reading ACT UP. Today's show, we're featuring wonderful Jim Brown and people from Penn State Berks Theatre Campus. So Jim is going to introduce his students, and we're going to learn about stage movement and stage combat. So hope you stay tuned. Be sure to watch closely.
You don't have to watch that closely. Thank you, Pat. Hi, my name is Jim Brown. I chair the theater program at Penn State Berks. We have a couple of designers and actors with us here today. There's Andrew Bush. Andrew, you have your own mic, so you can say hi.
Hi.
Yeah, I'm Andrew.
Hi, I'm Andrew.
Okay.
I'm a student designer.
Andrew recently did some work for Pat. He designed lights and sound for the production of
Death-Defying Acts.
I was stuck on Our American Cousin.
Oh, well, he helped with that show, too.
For Death-Defying Acts at the theater, and mm-hmm. he did sound and lighting design the Pat last semester.
Yep.
And you got a couple of things coming up that you're going to get assigned to, too.
Yep.
So, student opportunities to design at Penn State Berks. Here is...
I'm Taylor Clark. I'm Jim's patsy. I do everything for him that he doesn't have time to do. I'm also directing the fall workshop production.
Hi, I'm Kayla Kazmari. I'm just an actor and a student there.
There is no such thing as just an actor.
I am an actor and a student.
There you go.
My name is Griffin Cook. I'm the new guy to the program and will be in this fall's upcoming show.
Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. I am Tommy Heiler, and I'm a student actor at Penn State Berks.
So we were going to do a little thing about stage combat at the end of the show, but 10 minutes ago, Pat said, why don't you do it at the beginning? It's like, well, okay, we were going to talk about our season first and the program, but let's talk about movement and stage violence, violence for the stage, violence for the camera. You're not really doing violence. What you're doing is learning how to dance together. So I'm going to stand up. I'm going to give warning to the camera people. I'm standing up now. I think you tracked with me. The basic thing about being on camera is some of the similar things with doing violence on stage. One, you have to dance together. You have to be cooperative, and you have to be where you can be seen for a lot of things, but you also have to hide certain things. You're not really hitting anybody if you're going to do stage violence. Taylor, would you stand up, please? He's standing up right behind me, I can tell. So if I turn and I actually hit him, he's not going to like me very much. So if we're going to do something on camera, we have to be aware of what's called camera eye view. You're hot, right? This is our camera that's hot. Yeah, he's giving me the high sign. So I got to stay in frame. I'm going to move real quick. Don't follow me. If I do something out of frame, you can't see it, can you? Same thing on stage. We have to be aware of audience eye point of view. Are you doing for a proscenium? Are you working for a thrust? Are you working full round? You have to design the actor's movement to say certain things about character and to tell the story. This is over here. I probably wouldn't heard very well. So I'm not used to microphones at this point. So what I'm going to do with Taylor and Tommy. Tommy, would you come up, please? There are a couple of simple kinds of movement that we use. I'm going to put the microphone down for a minute, and you're going to watch me. Certain kinds of moves that we do that are safe. If you guys would perpendicular this camera. So you're going to look at each other, and you're going to be perpendicular to the camera. This is their line of connection. And if you throw a punch, you have to cross it some way or another to cross the partner's body line. Now, if Taylor throws a simple right cross, he's going to punch from his right shoulder to Tommy's right shoulder. And this is what it looks like when they do it safely. They don't actually make contact. Throw the punch, boom. And Tommy, of course, responds to the stimulus, which makes his head turn. Now, on camera, we can add the contact digitally, but on stage we have to do it ourselves. So we either do a nap, a body nap, or a hand nap of some kind. So for this, since Tommy, you're going to be receiving the action, you will do the nap. Okay? Taylor, you will throw the punch. So they line up, throw the punch, and they're going to go fairly slow, and Tommy did a nap. Now, you can see that they can't make that they didn't make contact. If you're going to do something for audience point of view, you have to arrange it so that you see the movement start, and then you hide the fact that it doesn't make contact. You saw that, did you? Doesn't make contact, and then you have to show the result. So I'm going to turn them in such a way that the camera is going to be able to shoot over Taylor's right shoulder. Let's turn you. Okay, camera point of view is coming over you, so it needs to be right here. Tom, you need to line up so that the camera can no, you're going to line up right here so that the camera can see your face right over Taylor's shoulder, right here. So we hide certain things from the camera or from the audience's point of view. We show them the setup. We hide the fact that it doesn't actually hit Tommy's face as it crosses center line. The body of the actor masks from the camera that we're not actually making contact. And then Tommy's response to this is such that you see the aftermath. So if you would take a half a step toward me, Taylor. All right, that's good. Tommy, if you'll take a quarter of a step to your right. Good. All right, we just shifted camera eye point of view. Okay, set it up. Go nice and slow. Good. So, since you're working for camera, when you get over here, boom, drift the hand down. The camera will read it as it goes down. Tommy, if you would add the nap, let's do a nap on the hip. Your hip is hidden behind Taylor's hip. Nice and slow, too fast. Nice and slow. Now, Taylor, you're going to have to give a little hitch, aren't you? Because you're communicating. You have to communicate with whatever the audience is picking up. So in this case, the audience, through the camera, needs to read the shoulder that something's going to happen here. So if you will, bing. Need a little more hitch in the shoulder. Speed it up. Speed it up. Speed it up. Ready? Okay. Eyes to the partner. Eyes to the target. Execute. Bam. Now, whole body. Turn at the waist. The camera can pick you up all the way down to the waist, so let the body read all the way in. So what happens if he's funny? What happens if Tommy is Superman? Set it up in a different way. What if he's totally incompetent at moving? Let's do that first, and then let's do Superman. Switch? Nah. So, if he's totally incompetent and he doesn't quite know how to throw a punch, you begin to tell the story of the character with the limitation of body movement and the placement of energy. Of course, you can see what Tommy does. So, incompetence. You would isolate, you would only move from shoulder, you would not involve body at all, and there would be a real shortness of the punch. Throw. Not too much body. You feel it?
Yeah.
May I be you for one moment? Watch, watch. So there's nothing reading. There's nothing. It probably doesn't even reach him. You've seen it in movies where somebody would go, and of course nothing happens. So you can set up comedy with a limitation of what the actor does in terms of throwing some kind of a punch. One more time. Think Woody Allen. Okay, that begins to get to it. And of course the response from the partner who is receiving the energy should be concomitant to the type of energy coming in and the size of the energy coming in. Now, what if we have, well, I don't know, how would Hulk Hogan take a punch? If you have a character who sets up being impervious to energy, which, Tommy, you can give that illusion. And if this character is really seriously trying to do damage to the point where, see, the camera can't pick this up, but it would, you got to sink in and do the full turn and come through. But then nothing happens with the energy exchange. We can set up different kinds of relationship that way as well. Would you please? Slow. Now, what I really would like for you to think about, yeah, get the pivot going in the feet. That will read, even if you've only got half body, That'll read all the way to the ground for the audience. That's what you're thinking about. Boom. And of course, you wouldn't even turn. May I be you for him? I could never be you, but may I step in? So here he is. He throws the punch. You know, there's the delay of response. Bam! Right? Which communicates a certain thing about character relationship. You might even do one of the... I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done that. One more. Now, start picking up the pace. The pace of exchange of energy is what really begins to sell a choreography, and it begins to establish character and relationship. Right? So you build up the tempo slowly. We should do this over a period of weeks, but we don't have it. But these guys have worked together for a long time, so they can begin to pick up pace. May I be you for just a moment? Would you hold this?
Sure.
Tommy and I have worked together long enough. Slow-mo.
Okay. You want me to nap?
Yeah.
Okay.
And set. Set. Of course, he's my partner, and does a nice illusion. So, if you will, build it quick. And I think we're just about out of time for this.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Thank you, guys.
You said three.
So one of the things that we try to do both in curriculum and in show work is define character through sound production and movement, attach that to the action of the play so that they inhabit a character and then they learn to dance together. That's really a big part of our work. So, Pat, there you go.
It was very exciting. Yes, it was. I was worried about Tommy getting hurt.
Don't worry about Tommy getting hurt.
I got to tell something on Pat. I met Pat when I was teaching a movement class at Albright. And it was half La Bonne movement principles and half stage combat. And here was this lovely older lady. And she did a scene from Spring Awakening with a young actor. And what words can I not say here? They kicked heck out of each other.
Yeah.
This lady's scene. Really great. And then Julia told me who you were, and I thought, really?
Oh, dear.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Well, it
was. So Pat was really good at it.
Learned a lot in that class.
You were good. It was fun. That was a good group.
It was.
Okay.
And I'm glad you're still doing it.
We're having fun. See, those two have been in class, and we'll have you two pretty soon. So I guess we should probably start talking about this fall.
Well, sure. Shall we talk about this fall? Or you want to put Gayla to work?
Well, we can put her to work in talking about this fall.
Okay.
Our season, we have fall season and spring season. Our fall season, the first production is being directed by Taylor. It's called The Pavilion. And it's starring these three, and it will perform during Thanksgiving weekend at Penn State Berks. Those dates are Wednesday, 8:23. That's not right. That's the auditions. Wednesday, it's all on Wednesday. Wednesday, September the 20th, Friday, September 22nd, and Saturday, September 23rd at 8 p.m. in the Perkins Auditorium. This is where I'd like to involve you guys. The main stage I'm directing a production of the Scottish play for our main stage production, but we'll talk about that after these guys talk about the pavilion. Taylor's going to do a little setup because it's not one that a lot of people have heard of.
So The Pavilion is a play by Craig Wright, who is best known as one of the head writers for 6 Feet Under. He was nominated for at least 5 Emmys for that. I believe he won 2. The Pavilion takes place in Pine City, Minnesota in the year 2017, and it's all about a high school reunion in which Peter, played by Tommy, and Carrie, played by Kayla, reunite for the first time after 15 years. Things ended on a bit of a sour note between the two, to say the least, and they are accompanied by the omniscient narrator, played by Griffin, who plays 17 different characters. He plays every other person at their reunion except for the two of them. And Peter is there with the intent of trying to reunite with Carrie and rekindle their high school relationship. And Carrie is there to let Peter know how she feels, to put it mildly. So if you guys want to talk at all about, here, we'll start with you.
Hi. I know the production's going to be very emotional. Taylor's definitely pushing us very hard. So I'm enjoying the rehearsal. It's definitely going to be a stretch.
Yeah, there's a very real chance that the stage combat will become real combat in the process of rehearsals. So if you want to get some backstage tickets, see that. It'll be a good show. But I think one of my favorite things about this play, as is said in the opening monologue, verbatim, this is a play about time. High school reunions are a time for reminiscing, for nostalgia, for looking back, for reliving the old days, stories with your friends. And this kind of takes the opposite approach. You have Peter and Carrie, Peter trying to recapture the past, Peter trying to bring back what once was, in this setting with friends from their past. But the real theme, the real body of the show is about moving forward in time. It's about progressing. It's about evolving. And how when you try to go backwards, when you try to live in the past, it sets yourself up for a lot of danger and a lot of heartache and just tragedy.
A show like this is a wonderful opportunity for not just director types like Taylor or actor types like ourselves. The workshop productions that we do at Penn State Berks give many students an opportunity to get into productions that wouldn't normally be produced at the college level on a main stage level with tons of production and 600 lighting cues and 500 wardrobe things. It's a very simple show with a very simple emotional message, but doing workshop productions like this give so many people opportunities to do things that under other circumstances they wouldn't have an opportunity to. Most of the productions I've worked on since being at Penn State Berks have been a lot of characters, a lot of voices, very elaborate. We just did a musical last semester. We did a Greek tragedy in the fall. That this gives somebody like myself an opportunity to play more of a down character instead of an inflated one.
Yeah, and to piggyback off of what Griffin was saying, the message is very much about going forward. The word that we came up with in regard to his character and who is the entire show, more or less, is flow. It's all about releasing the flow of time and just following that river to its inevitable destination into the waterfall or the ocean or wherever rivers go. And as to build off of what Tommy was saying about the workshop productions, the show is written to be, in the script it says, just two benches suggests the setting. We're going to do a little bit more than just two benches, but the whole idea of the show is that it's very minimalist, and it reflects its simple emotional message.
Well, now, Taylor, when you say workshop, is this like something where you're studying and working along with this for an extended period of time? Or is it something where you sort of just cram in a couple weeks and mount it?
I'm going to rip that away from him. That's a really good question. What we are conceiving with the way we're putting seasons together is that we'll have two fully supported main stage productions that may well be faculty driven, but they'll certainly be faculty designed. The workshop productions are meant to be student driven.
Oh.
It may well be that, well, like last year, I directed the workshop production for the spring, and we did Greater Tuna.
That was a fun show.
With five actors playing 19 characters. But it's something that we can experiment with. They're really designed to be student-driven. I would love to get to the place where we have a student playwright, a student director, student designers executing everything. And it can be pretty much whatever they want it to be. so that they can do oddball things. They can do strange things. Our workshop productions last year were The Complete History of America, abridged, and Greater Tuna, two rather oddball scripts that would not be chosen for a main stage production. And I think they really did have a lot of fun experimenting and finding their own costumes and the reason why. Well, why am I going to choose this costume? What is it about this choice? It makes people sink into and decide, well, if we can only have three things, what are those three things going to be? Why are we going to choose them? And where are we going to steal them? I didn't say that. Because the budgets are low.
They're designed. Yeah, they're not really out stealing things, though, folks.
No, we're not. We really aren't.
You troublemaker.
Where can we get the precise thing that we will need that will say exactly what needs to be said about character, relationship, location, action? What's the principal action of the play? We need a bench. What kind of bench? Is it going to be a bus bench? Is it going to be a park bench? Is it going to be a curly cube? What does the bench say about who these people are, how they're living their lives, and what's going on in this particular moment? And we can use the workshops to help people get at that in a very creative way.
That's wonderful, because there's so many aspects that go into it. Like you're saying, what kind of bench? What kind of chair? What color would this character like to be in?
You want a cowboy hat? What kind?
Yeah, right.
What kind?
One, a floppy one.
The floppy, is it going to be pink? Is it going to be green?
No,
is it going to be black?
No,
is it going to be straw? Is it going to be felt?
Straw. Yeah.
So you're already making character decisions.
A little
strap.
Yeah.
Slider?
And slide a little feather inside there.
Feather? Does it slide or does it tie?
Oh, it's a slide up.
Okay, so it's...
See? So that's what you do, right?
And that's the kinds of decisions we would like for the students to acclimate themselves to make. Selections, decisions about location having something to do with theme, with action. The main stage productions, well, that's when we get people like Robin Buckwalter and Christopher Connolly and Corey involved asking. It might well be a student director. We had a student director for our fall main stage last year, and boy, did they put him through the ringer.
Yeah, no, what show was that?
That was called The Burial at Thebes.
Oh,
it was a version of
the Antigone
of Sophocles. And there were a number of production meetings.
And that was a student that directed
that? That was a student,
that?
Christopher
like
Crawford.
A very intense, classic, heavy show.
And they asked him many questions that made him go home and have sleepless nights and think of what it was that he wanted to choose and why he wanted to choose it. I think that's really what we're here for.
Yeah. Well, I thank you for answering what your workshop does.
Yeah. That's what it's designed to do.
Now, do you
make you sweat?
Do you bill it in the program? Do you let everyone, your audience, know that this has been generated by the students and it is a workshop?
It is a workshop production. It's billed as the workshop production as opposed to the main stage production. Everyone is admitted free. There is no charge for the workshop productions. Oh, and by the way, all high school students are invited free to every one of our productions. Just thought I'd throw that in.
That's great.
Even the main stages.
Yeah.
We've been given permission to have high school students, high school faculty, and high school theater staff, they can come to our productions for free.
That's excellent.
Just let me know.
A lot of people in Berks County, young people especially, are involved in theater.
Mm-hmm.
Many times with the high schools, though, what you notice is they're musicals.
Yes.
And musicals are wonderful.
They are.
But I have a friend that calls them fluff. You know, and that's because musicals are generally happy and lots of music, singing, dancing, colorful costumes.
Like that wonderful song, Attend the Tale of Sweeney Todd.
Yeah. Okay.
That nice, light, frothy musical.
Yeah, no, that's not a fluffy musical. That's true.
Corey's here. Hi, Corey.
Hello, Corey.
Here is our resident scenic designer, technical director, my teaching partner at Penn State Berks, Corey Palmer.
Why don't you pass the microphone over to her and she can say hello to everybody.
Hi, everybody. Sorry, there was traffic.
That's everybody's excuse in Reading anymore.
Yeah, well, what are you going to do? Yes, I am the technical director over at Penn State Berks and in charge of the design program. And hi. And we have a good time. We have a good time over there. We do. You can emphasize in lighting and sound design, or costume design, or scenic design, and you can practice doing all of that in our very own program. I don't know what we're talking about. What are we talking about?
We'll talk about that more at the end.
She reversed our order. We did stage combat first, and then we started talking about season and pavilion.
Yeah, too bad you missed it. They were really smacking each other around.
No.
Tommy cried.
Aww. Now, don't tell on him.
Oh. He's a good actor.
Are you sure you want to say things like that?
He'll get me back.
Yes, he will. vengeance is mine, saith Tommy. Yes. So the workshop production for the fall, the pavilion in September, homecoming weekend, we would invite you all to come see it. Then we are doing a production of the Scottish play. And these guys are already trying to tell me who to cast and how to cast. And I'm going to dangle them. He has, and yeah.
I wonder why.
And so we're going to have some fun with Temptation. The production, as we are conceiving it currently, will revolve around the notion of temptation. Everyone is always tempted. And, of course, the witches for this production will tempt. They will not do spells, per se.
Interesting.
You're not going to have a spell cast on Macbeth to make him do things. He and his wife will be tempted with various and sundry things. At this point, the way I'm conceiving it, the supernatural beings will never leave the stage. So there will always be... Oh, Corey's just got, really? First I've heard of that.
We haven't even had a production meeting.
It's just Robin and
oh,
I.
Oh, well, you're hearing the hot news off the
right
press.
Now.
Yeah.
Robin and I are talking Shakespeare? A
bit. Yes.
Okay, so people will be studying Shakespeare?
They will indeed, as run through my word processor.
Oh, okay.
So there's going to be some interesting notions of scansion and versification. Like,
well, sword fight.
Now, when are you doing this?
This is going to be, again, Wednesday. They're all Wednesday. Wednesday, November 8th through Saturday, November the 11th. I'm slightly dyslexic today. So, yes, this
is
the November show.
Well, that's a wonderful time, just because it's the fall, mm-hmm. and it's the eeriness of the dead trees and things like that.
And we'll
that,
have orange leaves blowing through. But
this
production is going to hinge on what happens when you are tempted. And we see what happens when Macbeth is tempted. We see what happens when Banquo is tempted.
Okay.
We see what happens
when... And everybody
when
knows at home, you figured it out. We're talking about Macbeth,
yes,
right?
Macbeth.
Because there's a superstition in the theater that you never say Macbeth.
Not in the theater.
Well, we're sort of in a studio. But anyway, it brings in evil, temptuous... things happen to productions.
And we did have some...
And I know this for a fact.
we did a couple of productions of it when I was working at the New York Shakespeare Festival, and we were very judicious with our language. We had a superstitious production manager who would make us go outside and turn around and spit and do all the stuff.
That you have to do for every theater that I've been at.
Yeah.
You know, spin around three times, throw salt over your shoulder.
Yep.
Go outside and spit.
Yep, all that good stuff.
Yeah, I must have been too young to learn those things at school or something.
Well, you are still young, Pat.
Oh, thank you, Jim.
29, right?
Yeah.
It's
forever.
Tough on you.
Never.
So I'm kind of curious, when you guys found out that was what we wanted to do, what have you been doing to prepare? Yeah, Tommy grew his hair.
Oh, come on.
You guys been doing any reading this summer? You been doing any thinking about Temptation and William Shakespeare? You've been doing some stuff. Tell us about your prep.
We know she's going to be cast.
Hi. Shakespeare is one of my loves, so I tend to be in a lot of productions. I was actually casted in a show of the Scottish play this summer, but I had to drop out because of work situations. But I love the language, and I just kind of have to read it, and it's different when you read it compared to performing it. So,
what role did you have, Kayla, that you had to give up?
I was the blood sergeant.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I got to be a witch. I loved it. I loved it. I had a beard. It was great.
They did that.
Yeah, I instantly started growing my beard out.
Mm-hmm. It's very magnificent.
I know. Thank you. It's I feel if I'm going to be a Scotsman, I should probably have a nice ginger beard. So I decided to start growing that out.
When it got brought up that we were going to be performing Shakespeare, obviously it's very overwhelming at first and challenge accepted, but there's many things you'll look into of, you know, trying to understand iambic pentameter, trying to understand the language of Shakespeare, whether I feel a lot of times it's a love hate, there's rarely a gray with it. And for many people that may not love Shakespeare, but will still see a production of it that may not speak or understand that language, I believe it's the actor's responsibility and the director's responsibility with the entire production to make it interesting and make you want to love Shakespeare and understand the universe they exist in, why they say the things they say. And it really helps when you look up a lot of Shakespearean texts that are updated so you understand what some of the words from then would mean now.
Yeah, also the history.
Oh, the history.
The history of the lines and how they what they're really saying and talking about.
Yes.
It's a wonderful, wonderful, absolutely wonderful form of prose.
Oh, it's very unique in itself. And again, a challenge that I think any actor should be grateful to have.
Yeah, another thing I enjoy about Shakespeare is that much like how in a musical, the music kind of informs the different intentions and actions an actor will play, the iambic pentameter does a very similar thing. Like the way you say the lines, like where the beats are and where the offbeats are, really helps you pick a direction for your character to move in, both physically and emotionally. Jim, are you texting?
Put right your now? Toy away.
It's one of our other teachers.
Put your toy away.
The work truly never ends.
I didn't know we had to disarm people. Yeah.
Maria Mogford teaches our 102 and 105 courses, and she was hoping to get here today to be able to talk about that, but she's stuck in traffic.
Hey!
Coming back from the Jersey Shore. So
well, that's a little bit farther away than what your excuse was.
I'll have to talk about her 102 and 105 classes.
So should we talk about the spring?
Good
report. Sure, let's talk about the spring. Sure. In the springtime, we've got something possibly quite interesting for the workshop production. We have a young African-American man who is highly trained and skilled in dance. He's been working with Phil at Dance Co. since he was 9 years old, I believe. And Keith is a phenomenal mover.
Yeah,
he's a very good choreographer, and he loves musical theater. And we batted around an idea or two, and I looked at him at the end of the semester and said, well, since you want to direct a musical and you have all this other experience, what would happen if you took some of the stuff that we talked about? I did a tutorial with him on American musical theater, and he really liked the vaudeville. And I said, what would happen if you tried to put together a vaudeville program or a cabaret performance of some kind? And he has taken the bait. We talked over the weekend, and he has put together a vaudeville format that he would like to try to execute.
Oh, that would be a lot of fun.
It might well be, and you know, he's going to write some things. He's going to put some things. Yeah, we'll see what happens with it. We're going to work on it all summer. So maybe by the time we reconverge at the end of August, he will have some type of a vaudeville format put together that we can then spend the semester finding people to do, opening it up to people from the community, opening it up to people from outside the major, and helping him put together something that he can do direction, choreography, and coaching for singing, which are the kind of the things he loves to do. That's at this point, the workshop production. And Taylor wants to be a director.
To be everything.
Well, yes, but he wants to be a director. So one of the things since we have the flexibility within our degree program to be able to do this, The workshop production that he's directing this fall will be his non-thesis production, and the supported production he's directing in the main stage production he's directing in the spring, where faculty designers will go to town on him, that will be his thesis production and be a capstone experience, major research, major paper. And he's had some ideas. What are you thinking now?
Right now I'm leaning towards the Neil Simon piece. I'm a big fan of Neil Simon. I love pretty much everything he's ever written, to be completely honest with you. I like how he is unafraid to take experiences from his real life and then put them out for the world to see. Currently, I'm leaning towards Biloxi Blues because for some reason our program is the only theater I've ever worked in that has an abundance of men, and straight men at that. It makes no sense whatsoever. What? That's honest. We have three women. One of them's a professor. So I'm leaning towards Biloxi Blues because it's all about a bunch of guys in World War II getting drafted and the experiences that they go through right before being deployed to the European front. And it is a hysterical piece. Absolutely hysterical.
Sounds hysterical.
Oh, it is. It's funny. I'll make it funny.
Yeah. Well, Neil Simon does a wonderful job making things funny. What about you, Mr. Andrew? You're sitting here so patiently, quietly. And I see you have copious notes on your paper.
Yeah, this is all about
you've got a lavalier.
Yeah. I don't know, this is just about the department as far as design. We get to use a lot of nice equipment in... slowly, but we get to use a lot of the nice equipment and we rent a lot of it out. That's basically it. I mean, there's all, as far as design, you can do a lot in theater here at Berks, so.
Well, may I ask you to talk about your evolution in the last 2.5 years?
As far as what?
As far as actually being a functional designer.
Well,
who
you've come a long way,
knows
baby.
Knows how to communicate and whom to communicate with and how do you think as a designer? What have you learned? Have you learned anything?
Yes. I learned stuff. I just it's more about like what helps the play or musical, and you know what furthers the plot.
I'm going to throw you a curve. What's the difference between thinking like an engineer and thinking like a designer? And where's the interface? Andrew is an engineering major.
Yes.
And a theater minor.
Yep.
And he came in thinking like an engineer.
Yes.
And talking like an engineer and communicating like an engineer. Mm-hmm. And you're beginning to communicate like a designer. And you're beginning to think like a designer. What's the difference? Tell them.
I don't know. You're definitely throwing me a curve.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? But it's something that I think you can begin to formulate, mm-hmm. because there are different thought processes involved and different ways of communicating involved.
Yep.
Put your finger on it. You had to talk to Pat in certain ways just too much, just what, 6 weeks ago?
Yep.
Yeah.
I know. I noticed the difference.
When we first got Andrew in there and he wanted to do lights and stuff, all he would talk about is, so you want it brighter? Right? Yeah. You want this spot brighter and that spot over there darker.
Yeah.
Right? What cool toy can I play with? Now you talk about, oh, so you want it to feel like despair.
Yeah.
Like... And it's very, very different. You'll notice that you're talking about mood instead of talking about equipment, mm-hmm. right? And you have to know the equipment, obviously. And I think that a lot of the engineering students that we have would do well to take a couple of theater programs classes.
I think everybody should take theater.
Because their clients are going to talk like theater people.
Yeah.
And they're not going to talk like engineers. Yeah. And they're going to have to translate... I don't know. I want it to be blonder into something that's actually a functional looking piece. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yep.
Which is how directors talk. Mm-hmm. Right, Jim?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Can you do that again? Blue?
What?
Blonder.
I want it to be blonder.
No, blue. It needs to go blue.
All goes blue. Yeah. Right. Okay.
What? Yeah. Directors.
Yeah. Until you get to Tech Week, and then they're all, I don't know, just make it darker.
Turn the lights out! Griffin, how are you going to look forward to doing 17 characters?
I'm going to probably need to be heavily medicated to condense it all into one personality. But I've really always just, to amuse myself, to amuse other people, I do voices, I do characters, I do personality. I mean, everyone in theater does, but it's about caricatures, it's about creating life behind all the different people bouncing around. And that's basically what I'm doing in the show. It's It's one central figure, the narrator directing the play. He is creating the action, basically, setting the framework for the two former lovers to interact in the same space. But then he's also kind of taking on all of these other figures who are well-known in their life, and it's kind of playing off of them as much as it is playing off himself. It's about, you know, kind of who these people are that they know, their friends. And it's kind of a similar thing in real life, you know, just making all the different pieces of your life, your different friendships, relationships, kind of putting it together, making the connections. So it's not all scatterbrained and all over the place. It's just kind of finding the most efficient way to network and create the connection, so it's easier to just back and forth jump around. And then you add in some different accents, some different pitches, and then you've got different people.
Yeah, it's going to be a very interesting play, The Pavilion.
Yeah, we spent 5 hours last week with him in my living room. I'm like, okay, so what's this person's deal? Like, what's that person's objective? What do they want? And then he would go through and pick an actor or a certain character, and then we would build another character around them. Who did we come up with for the sheriff?
Patrick Warburton. You may know him as David Putty from Seinfeld. Basically, it's the idea of you take a character, you take their core concepts, and then I try to find a voice. So I'm thinking he's stiff, he's strong, and one of his lines is, "I've never been very funny." So it's more funny if he's not funny, very stoic, very flat. So then David Putty from Seinfeld just kind of seems right. So, I mean, that's basically the process. It's coming with an idea, it's coming with a theme, then okay, what do we do with this? How does this relate? How does this play? I've had several characters where I've tried to do a voice, and it's just not going to project in a theater space. So unfortunately, as much as in my head, it sounds right, it feels right, it's not going to play right, so it isn't the right answer.
Well, hi, Pat.
Hi. Well, it seems like you guys have an awful lot of fun out there at Penn State Berks.
And while we have fun, we get to earn a degree.
I think that's
wonderful.
So
let's talk about the kinds of degrees we can possibly earn at Penn State Berks.
And, you know, it's wonderful. Yeah. You've got a four-year program out there.
We do. We do indeed. So at Penn State Berks, we can do a BA. The BFAs are at other schools. We will be the only Penn State institution that will offer the BA performance option in theater. So you can come to Penn State Berks and get either an acting track, a design tech track, or a directing track. And we can individualize your curriculum for that particular choice. If you take all of the required courses, and you will have to take all of the required courses, that's why they're required courses, you have to take them. You will only earn 27 hours. You must have a total of 36 hours to be eligible to graduate. Most people will have somewhere between 45 and 50 hours of degree work. If you are an actor, you would fill out those requirements, those hour requirements, with some type of an acting project in a production, possibly doing some type of work other than acting, but on production. There'll be production credits. So we'll take the work that we do in the laboratory, the classroom, and apply it to production, and you'll fill out your 40, 45, 50 hours of theater work. If you're a director, you get credit for directing productions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you are a designer, you will design things in your area of expertise. Mm-hmm. Like Corey said, Corey is an artist. She is a wonderful visual artist. She paints as well as designs. And the recommendation that I got from a colleague who will remain unnamed, where she did a residency, she can build anything with nothing, and she's good with the kids.
So we have someone who can design and build and teach other people how to design and build. We have a very fine resident costume designer. We have a fine resident lighting designer. And we dabble in sound design as well. That is the youngest of the design areas in theater. And it still isn't completely codified at a lot of major universities. Uh-huh. When I was at Florida State, we had a person who did sound design, but he wasn't faculty, and so he couldn't teach anybody anything. It is. But we do have a faculty member who oversees sound design. What am I leaving out?
Well, the program as a whole has a very strong focus on ensemble work. I know I used to go to a different university, and our program there, while it was very good before it was cut, so I guess it couldn't have been that good. It was good.
It was good.
But it was more, as far as the students were concerned, it was more about a battle of wills and star power, whereas at Penn State Berks, it's very much a focus on ensemble work. It's a focus on everyone coming together as a team and working together to create one solid project, rather than about each individual actor only going out for their own glory or the designer going out just for their name in the program. It's everyone works together because we don't have a choice. We kind of have our backs against the wall, so we're just trying to do the best work that we possibly can all the time.
And actually, you guys won a KCACTF certificate for ensemble work for your work on Godspell.
Yes,
yeah, you are correct.
Wait, what?
Well, congratulations. Didn't anyone tell you?
When we go to KCACTF.
Well, no, they told him at the adjudication. He just doesn't remember. You were told.
We were all in a bit of a haze.
Yeah. We just finished a musical.
Yeah. That's hard. Well, I'm very appreciative of all you guys coming over. It's wonderful to have everyone here. And the last group that we had here were young people from high school. Mm-hmm. And it's not everybody needs to be in high school or a young collegiate person to be involved in theater. No offense, Tom, but you look like a grown up to me.
Sometimes.
He's got you fooled.
Well, I want to thank everybody for joining us and speak a little bit about what's coming up in local community theater. The Little Mermaid is going to be opening in June 23rd and 24th at the Miller Center. And Genesius is going to be opening that same weekend, Sideshow. We're looking forward to the Yoakum. It's doing Midsummer Night's Dream, more Shakespeare. So it should be a really nice summer that way for everyone to go and enjoy the Bard. We have a lot of things going on. We're so happy that we're being involved with Penn State. ACT has been blessed by being allowed to perform over there at Perkins Auditorium. And I guess it was last year we had a show in the art gallery called Art, which was very different sort of a play. I was very surprised. I had no idea what to expect. And Margie Wald and her cast did a very nice job. We're so happy to be able to come and play at your house, since two of our theaters don't have anywhere to perform. And we look forward to being engaged and getting even more involved in supporting your efforts, and because you're supporting ours, and we really appreciate that. And at one time, there was the Penn State Berks Summer Theater Program, and that was started by a dear friend and my mentor, Betty Lou McLean. And in all honesty, they have a four-year program because of all the work she did for many, many years. So we're very appreciative of that. She was very involved in community theater, and we, a teacher, at the Wyomissing Institute of Fine Arts. So come to their shows, come out there. High school people, remember, you can come and see their shows for free. And they're very approachable people. I hope you can tell that. You can certainly talk to Jim. Make sure you have plenty of time. He's a wonderful conversationalist, and will share every and all information with you. So, and I thank you so much to your students.
And the auditorium is getting a renovation over the summer.
Yay!
So by the time you all come back, it's going to look much better.
Oh, are the curtains coming?
The curtains are coming. Yay. Everything else is coming. We're getting all of these fixes. It's going to be great.
That's wonderful. Yeah. Thanks a lot, Corey, for sharing that. So I guess we're taping this today because Berks County Television is going to be getting a facelift and some new exciting things happening with their digitals, and they're going to get a green screen, so maybe we can even play with that sometime, you know, fly through space, you know, whatever, you know, bounce off someone's head, you know. So it's going to be real interesting, and we really appreciate your support, and I hope that you all come back in August, and check us out in August and see what we're up to then. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Greater Reading ACT UP on BCTV is supported by the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters.